Stay tuned for the news with Brian Williams. I'm Jack Ford. Have a good night.
Introducing Precision Movements by Raymond Watt.
Local forecast.
Visit the Varsifal Collection. Available at fine jewelers.
When it hurts so much you can hardly swallow ordinary food, get this.
Sandpiper's bankrupt and I used up all our savings.
Oh, no!
Well, at least she's taking it well. Then a fresh Wednesday Boston Commons.
Got a painful canker sore? Get Vicks Chloraseptic Spray. It numbs canker sore pain on contact with a powerful anesthetic for fast, effective relief. Vicks Chloraseptic Spray quickly numbs the pain away.
Tomorrow on Internight, Ransom director Ron
Action.
Howard.
The directing is nearer and dearer to my heart, is what I'm doing now, and so I'm proudest of that.
Tomorrow at 8 Eastern on MSNBC.
Remember when Dr.
Touch my stereo equipment. Walk and chew gum. Okay then. Hit a baseball, cross the street, remove an appendix, or basically anything else that requires.
You get facts.
The More You Know, sponsored by Mitsubishi.
When a mother tries to teach her rebellious daughter a lesson.
To subscribe, just call this toll-free number.
Do it now, and you'll also get 3 bonus medical reports and a yearly index, plus this handy bonus binder. You'll even receive Stretching Your Healthcare Dollars as a free gift.
Call 800-641-1919 to get 12 monthly issues, plus medical reports, index binder, and free booklet, all for just $24. Use your credit card, or we'll bill you in 3 easy payments. Call 800-641-1919 now.
Good evening. This day started off with a disaster in the skies over India, the worst mid-air collision in the history of modern aviation. There are no survivors, and as of airtime tonight, no known cause. We'll have a report. We'll talk to an expert about what might have happened there. We have 3 trials to update you on tonight. That pre-winter Midwest storm is still raging tonight. This was a showdown day in the Texaco case, and that case involving those tapes recorded the voices of company executives. You may recall we had Reverend Jesse Jackson on this broadcast last night. Today, he squared off with company executives at corporate headquarters. We'll report to you what they had to say. And why the music you buy at Walmart may have been cleaned up without your knowledge. A big story off the front pages of today's New York Times. We'll look at the First Amendment issues involved and what is happening in the sanitization of music at that Walmart discount store chain. First tonight, though, the disaster in the skies over India and the investigation into what caused it. We begin with the very latest from NBC's Robert Hager.
Tonight, small pieces of flaming debris are all that remain of the 2 craft, which hit and plummeted nearly 3 miles into a rural area. A part of a wing, pieces of ribbing, the Saudi plane's logo, and luggage. 3 passengers may have lived for just a few moments, but otherwise there were no signs of life. All aboard both planes perished. And at the New Delhi airport, where anxious relatives had kept a vigil, now they got the grim news. Sad word of loved ones lost. Suddenly, unexpectedly. One plane, a Saudi Arabian 747, had just taken off from New Delhi, headed for Tehran. The other, inbound from Kazakhstan, was a Soviet-made craft operated by the Kazakh National Airline. As they converged 40 miles southwest of New Delhi, U.S. pilots of a military supply plane 50 miles away watched and later telephoned this description.
A large cloud lit up with an orange glow. From within or behind the cloud, the glow stayed and became brighter in intensity and lit up the area very bright. Fireballs seemed to appear heading in our general direction, not in our immediate vicinity, but in our general direction, diverging away from each other. The glow intensity of the cloud became dimmer, and the two fireballs proceeded to descend down and hit the ground.
Authorities will be examining the possibility of human error, either by air traffic controllers or more likely by pilots of one of the planes. The controller said they'd given permission to the climbing Saudi plane to climb only to 14,000 feet and the descending Kazakh plane to descend only to 15,000 feet.
If so, that should have kept the planes 1,000 feet apart, but something went wrong. Former NTSB investigator Paul Turner speculates.
It's entirely possible that there was a language barrier. The you have Soviet pilots on one aircraft and Saudi pilots on another aircraft, and I would expect they would be talking in English.
The air traffic control system aviation relies on today was first developed after another historic collision over the Grand Canyon nearly 40 years ago. 128 died when a United DC-7 and a TWA Constellation hit. Nowadays, U.S. pilots in simulators on the ground get extensive training to avoid collisions. U.S. air traffic control centers are required to have automatic alarms which give advanced warnings of impending collisions. And another system called TCAS must be mounted in the cockpits of all airliners in the U.S. to first give a visual and audio warning to pilots.
Traffic.
And finally give instruction of evasive action to take.
Climb.
But while Saudi planes are generally well-equipped and many of the Saudi pilots trained by the U.S. Air Force, the Kazakh line, which uses many Russian pilots, is a remnant of the now defunct Soviet airline Aeroflot, known for aging, poorly maintained equipment and sometimes mediocre training. Whatever investigators of today's crash eventually find, tonight 351 are dead. Robert Hager, NBC News, Washington.
So all of this leaves us with the question tonight, what could have caused two aircraft to be on the same course and collide somehow in midair? And to give us some possible answers tonight, even though it's early, veteran aviation expert David Stempler is with us from our Washington Bureau. Thanks for coming in tonight.
Good to be with you, Brian.
First of all, a question, since it was raised in the Hager piece we just saw, two-part question, really. Is English the universal language of air traffic control, and could there have been a language barrier with the heavily accented English of a Russian pilot and an Indian pilot?
Well, in theory, English is supposed to be the language used in all air traffic control. In certain countries, internally, we find that it's not used. We know that happens in Colombia and a variety of other places. People are speaking Spanish there, or they're speaking their native language. But then you add the fact that we had a Saudi pilot speaking English, a Kazakhstan pilot speaking English, and some of the accents of the Indian controllers. I know pilots who fly in that environment who find it very difficult to understand some of the air traffic controllers.
What else do you know about that region, flying in that region specifically, problems that might be germane to the airspace over India, say?
Well, we know that the radar coverage in India tends to be poor. Now, we checked our records tonight, and this area where the plane crashed was within radar coverage. But there are lots of parts of India that are not. So generally, the air traffic control system in India is weak, very, very outdated, and antiquated in many ways. They fly sometimes in narrow corridors because the military, the Indian military, uses up so much airspace. That could have been a part of it. Another component, Brian, may be the issue here that the Kazakhstan, the former nation to the Soviet Union, tend to use the metric system for their altitudes, whereas most of the other countries, for example, India, would use the foot measure. So they may have given altitude in feet. The cockpit devices are all measuring meters. They would have had to do a conversion in the cockpit. Maybe they made an error on the Kazakh airplane.
Is there anything else historically, generically almost, that can cause a midair?
We could have altimeter errors. You know, as these planes are descending, they're coming down from their cruising altitude. They get down to what's called the transition altitude, where they have to reset their altimeters to the local altitude and density, for example, the New Delhi area. If they make a mistake in resetting the altimeters, that could throw you off by thousands of feet. And although they thought they were descending to 15,000 feet, maybe they went beyond that.
What is known about both of these air carriers, if anything, safety-wise?
Well, I've got to tell you, Saudia, the Saudi Arabian National Airline, is probably one of the safest airlines in the world. I've rated it as such. And of all the non-Western airlines, it ranks among them. It's one of the few non-Western carriers to be that way. The Kazakhstan airline is one of the baby flots, as they call them, one of the breakaways from Aeroflot. And has all the deficiencies of Aeroflot and even more, if that's possible.
Well, for our audience, meaning aircraft with low maintenance, crowded conditions on board if you're a passenger, and generally slipshod operating?
Absolutely. It's pretty bad. When the former Soviet Union broke up, those planes that were in the individual countries remained there. But under the old Soviet system, as people remember, everything was centrally controlled out of Moscow.
Yeah.
And it was true for Aeroflot with maintenance and operations or whatever. So they got the planes, but not much else in Kazakhstan and other nations.
David Stempler, a man we turn to in situations like this, thank you once again from our bureau in Washington tonight.
Happy to help.
By one estimate, this is a staggering number. There are 500,000 people in the air during any given hour every day. That is 500,000 people airborne right now as we speak. And that is one way of saying that mid-air collisions are extremely rare. And the tragedy in India today was the worst mid-air collision ever and the third deadliest aircraft accident ever. The worst ever occurred in March 1977 in Spain's Canary Islands. 582 people were killed when two Boeing 747s, a KLM and a Pan Am, you may remember this one, collided on a runway in Tenerife. The second deadliest accident happened in August 1985. That's when a Japan Airlines 747 crashed into a mountain in Japan, killing 520 people. Today's accident, as we mentioned, was the third deadliest in all of aviation, with so far 351 people counted among the dead. It has been 3 months since the crash of TWA Flight 800, and a cause has yet to be given there, as you know. Because of their building frustration, the families of the French victims of that crash have chosen to hire their own private aviation expert. The families do feel that American authorities have done good work so far, but because the Americans can't or won't release any information yet, the families, the French families that is, believe their expert may be more apt to give them answers sooner. We have a lot more to tell you about this evening as the news continues for you on this Tuesday. A verdict in the so-called talk show trial tonight. We'll have details on the court case that some say may change the face of what we see on daytime TV. And the Simpson trial, part two, goes on, and now there is a third courtroom involved. We'll explain that and more after this.
What's the Pentagon's response to hardliner aggression against the democratic government in Russia?
We're taking no action. Ladies and gentlemen, the president wants to make it clear that the United States military is not and will not get involved in internal Soviet matters.
We've heard reports of a covert military unit in the area. Can you confirm this?
Trust me, we are not involved.
Soviet strike.
If you've got minor arthritis pain, you could take four Advil in the course of the day, or six Tylenol. On the other hand, you could take just two Aleve. It's just on the label. It's your choice.
Aleve. All day strong, all day long.
Straight talk about hair restoration with Dr. L. Lee Bosley.
What exactly is hair transplantation?
We simply take excess hair follicles from the back of the patient's head, where he usually has more hair than he needs, and we transplant them to the front of his head, where they then grow permanently for the rest of his life.
Why should I do it now?
I've had patients report to me that they have been so dispirited by hair loss that they've stayed home, haven't been going out, and after their hair is restored, it's almost miraculous that they start having dates, start going out, and it's like night and day in terms of having greater confidence and as well a better professional or business life.
Don't wait another day to do something about your hair loss. Call 1-800-980-4300 now for this free guidebook and video from the Bosley Medical Institute. That's 1-800-980-4300. It could be one of the most rewarding calls you ever make.
Now get 24 issues of the New New Yorker week after week for just $19.98. Save $40 off the cover price and get the special cartoon collection free with your paid subscription. Call 1-800-952-2626.
There was a verdict announced today in a much-talked-about trial that sadly said a lot about our popular culture these days, the talk show culture specifically, a trial that brought some changes even before today's verdict was announced. Our report on the end of the so-called Jenny Jones case from NBC's Jim Cummins.
It was called the Same-Sex Secret Show by Jenny Jones producers. Scott Amador described the man of his dreams.
What's so exciting about him to you?
He's got a cute little hard body.
That was Jonathan Schmitz, who came on the Jenny Jones show believing he was going to meet the girl of his dreams.
Did you think Donna had the crush on you?
Did I? No, we're good friends.
Well, guess what? It's Scott that has the crush on you.
You lied to me.
Can you tell us what your status is? I mean, are you involved with anybody? Or?
No, but I am definitely a heterosexual, I guess you could say.
The show never aired because 3 days after it was taped, police say Schmitz murdered Amador. At the trial, Schmitz's father testified his son has a history of mental illness, and his lawyers argued that this humiliating experience on the Jenny Jones show pushed him over the edge.
Because I think she's responsible. I think she's the one who put the train on the tracks, turned the engine on, turned her back, and walked away.
Prosecutors said that is nonsense.
This isn't the Jenny Jones case. This is the murder of Scott Amador case.
But Jones herself did take the stand. She was subdued and couldn't remember much.
Did you ever think that if you didn't go for that extra little setup to pull that last bit of emotion out, that maybe this terrible tragedy which brings us together today wouldn't have occurred?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Actually, sensationalistic talk shows, especially the concept of ambush television, were on trial with Jonathan Schmitz. It seems both were convicted. The jury decided to give Schmitz a break. He had been charged with first-degree murder. They convicted him of second-degree murder. But at least one juror, Joyce O'Brien, was less forgiving of the Jenny Jones show.
I think that was a total ambush, and I don't care how else you want to say it. They took a young man, and basically they destroyed one person's life, his family's life. The other person is deceased. His family's ruined, all because of sensationalism and money and talk shows. I think that's terrible.
Jones refused to be interviewed about the verdict. In a written statement, she and her producer said the end of the criminal trial doesn't lessen the sadness and sorrow we feel about the senseless murder of Scott Amador. Jonathan Schmitz will be sentenced later. He faces up to life in prison with the possibility of parole after 15 years. Jim Cummins, NBC News.
In Connecticut, a judge declared a mistrial today in the first of two rape cases against Alex Kelly, that former high school wrestler who lived as a fugitive in Europe, really, for 9 years. Lawyers for both sides say the jurors were hopelessly deadlocked, split 4-2 in favor of convicting Kelly. The prosecutor says he'll retry Kelly before moving on to the second rape case that is pending against him. Kelly's accused of raping two teenagers when he was a high school senior. O.J. Simpson faced legal battles on two fronts today. He's defending himself in civil court in the wrongful death suit against him. And in family court, Simpson's custody fight over his two children started today. NBC's George Lewis has that story.
O.J. Simpson this morning fighting for the custody of his two youngest children. The family of his murdered ex-wife, Nicole, wants to keep the kids.
There's a gag order.
Nicole's sister Denise and other participants in the child custody case have been ordered not to speak to the press. The trial is taking place behind closed doors. And in another courtroom, 30 miles from the custody case, the families of the murder victims continue their lawsuit against Simpson. Today saw a sharp series of exchanges between Simpson lawyer Bob Baker and Dr. Werner Spitz, an expert witness hired by lawyers for the families. Dr. Spitz, a forensic pathologist, contends that the victims were murdered by a single assailant with a single knife, that the victims died quickly, within a minute or so, that cuts on O.J. Simpson's hand were a result of fingernail scratches, not a broken glass, as Simpson contends. In court, Baker tore into Spitz, accusing the pathologist of bias. "You are a partisan advocate as you sit in the witness chair, are you not?" Baker thundered. "Absolutely not," Spitz shot back. At one point, Baker offered to let Spitz demonstrate on him how someone could use his fingernails to claw chunks of a person's flesh. "Gouge me," he challenged. But Judge Hiroshi Fujisaki put a stop to it. "Mr. Baker, there will be no gouging of flesh out in my courtroom," he warned. Eventually, the expert demonstrated on his own arm, leaving deep impressions with his fingernails, but not breaking the skin. Later in this case, the defense will call its own forensic expert, Dr. Michael Bodden, to refute the Spitz testimony. Bodden, appearing Friday on the CNBC program Rivera Live, disagrees on a number of points, including how long the killings took.
"I think that when one takes into account all the circumstances, the scene, the area, I think that that struggle was more than 5 minutes.
Biden's appearance on TV drew a warning from the judge today. He said if any more defense experts or experts for the other side appear on television, they won't be permitted to testify. Brian?
A particularly graphic day in that trial. And about this custody matter, how long, what format will that take, and how long does that go on?
Well, it's all behind closed doors, so we are not sure how long it will take. Some of the estimates from some of the legal experts we've been talking to range from 2 to 3 weeks.
All right, NBC's George Lewis tonight in Santa Monica, California, where there's now two Simpson courtrooms and two separate matters going on. Thanks, George. When we continue, a household name, a major appliance maker that is also a major employer, announces some major layoffs today. We'll have that and the rest of this day in business and more after this.
I'd like to tell you about a company you may have heard of called American Standard. Sure, I know what you're thinking. American Standard, those are the guys that make toilets. True, but that's only part of the picture. They're actually a global company. In fact, they're the leading foreign producer of plumbing products in China. And if you've heard of Train air conditioners, that's an American Standard company, too. They're one of the largest makers of commercial air conditioning systems in the world.
So, American Standard does a lot more than just make toilets.
Oh, yeah. Their WABCO division created the anti-lock braking system found on half the heavy commercial vehicles built in Europe today. American Standard. More than you ever expected.
Tonight on Internight, legalize pot for medical use. How will it be enforced? Tom Brokaw asks the nation's drug czar. Tonight at 11 Eastern on MSNBC.
You're not with AT&T, are you?
No, I'm not.
So, are you happy?
Not really.
I was happier with AT&T. Well, we're making it simple to come back. How'd you like to get 100 free minutes just for switching to AT&T?
That would be wonderful.
That's a real gift.
Well, there's a lot more. Introducing the new AT&T One Rate Plan. Just 15 cents a minute on calls from home to anybody, anytime, anywhere in America.
That's great. It's a flat rate.
Anytime, anybody, anywhere.
I'm going to presume there's going to be a charge involved.
No, it's free.
It's even better.
No fees, no minimum spending, no time requirements, no restrictions, no games.
You can't beat that.
Call 1-800-YES-2-ATT. You'll get one low rate plus 100 free minutes for switching to AT&T. So what do you think?
I think 100 free minutes is awesome.
The one rate plan is excellent.
And there's no restrictions, no limits.
So what are you going to do?
Pick up the phone and switch to AT&T.
One rate, 100 minutes. Call 1-800-YES-2-ATT to switch.
There was news on the smoking and health front today. A study coming out in tomorrow's Journal of the American Medical Association shows that a flawed enzyme, which is present in millions of Americans, can raise the risk of breast cancer. This shows that postmenopausal women who are heavy smokers, including those who started smoking in their teens, have about four times the risk of developing breast cancer as that of non-smokers who also carry this flawed enzyme. There should be more in tomorrow's papers on this. And a call to action for the American healthcare industry today. Researchers warning the cost of treating long-term chronic illness is likely to skyrocket unless fundamental changes are made to the entire healthcare system. We're not talking about life-threatening problems like heart attacks, but chronic ones like diabetes and arthritis. The foundation estimates about 100 million Americans suffer from long-term illnesses. They predict that number will grow to almost 150 million over the next 30 years. That could cost the American healthcare system almost $800 billion. They just can't stop doing whatever it is on Wall Street. The Dow hit another record high today, the fifth in a row now. The blue chip index scampered up 10.5 points to close to 6266. Volume was heavy, but the NASDAQ composite index fell 6 points today to close at 1256 in heavy trading. Here now with more on the Dow and the appliance giant that is slicing off a major part of itself, Doesn't that sound pleasant? CNBC's Ron Insana is here. Ron, this is about the Sunbeam folks, correct?
Indeed it is. Well, a gentleman who is known as Chainsaw Al, this is Al Dunlop, a man who is a corporate turnaround specialist, back in July took over the helm of Sunbeam, a troubled consumer products company that has been really disappointing Wall Street with its profits over the last seven quarters. And he announced a major restructuring plan today under which he will discontinue 87 independent product lines at the company, slash the payrolls by half. That means 6,000 workers will be gone. It's going to shut down factories and take a rather large charge of $300 million to restructure the company in an effort to cut $225 million in costs.
I think we have a picture of this gentleman. What do we know about this chainsaw gentleman?
Well, you know, I know Al personally and have for maybe a year or so now. He is a very congenial man in social settings. He is, however, a very hard-nosed manager who said, with respect to Sunbeam, that this company had 18 months left to live, and if he didn't restructure it radically, and maybe ultimately put it up for sale as he did with Scott Paper, another turnaround that he engineered. He cut 11,200 jobs there, sold the company, and netted about $100 million for himself in the process, we should add. But he sold the company at a rich premium to its then stock price and did well for shareholders. Employees, a different constituency, and certainly a different result.
And what kind of products will they be left with? I mean, we all know the household brand Sunbeam. What are they going to make now?
They're going to make a lot of the same things when it comes to kitchen appliances. They're going to make irons that turn off automatically. They're going to pretty much stay with those the kitchen brands and the consumer products things, items like irons, blenders, Mixmasters, and the like. They're going to get rid of outdoor patio furniture. They'll still make barbecues. He's trying to double revenues to $2 billion and increase profitability greatly. Now, one of the little tricks they use these days on Wall Street, these experts will take really large charges against earnings and use the excess cash to manage profits going forward, so the results look really good.
We shall see if this is like past performance, as they say. Ron
Insana. No guarantee of future results.
You got it. Took the words right out of my mouth. Ron Insana, thanks.
Sure, Brian.
When we come back after a break tonight, what is going on in the American Midwest and who will stop the snow? A report from the front after this.
If you're ready to do business on the internet and you're wondering where to start, then the fastest growing internet provider in America invites you to get on board. Now, no matter what size your business is, AT&T makes it easy to catch the wave.
When it hurts so much you can hardly swallow ordinary food, get Vicks Chloraseptic Spray. It numbs sore throat pain on contact with a powerful anesthetic for fast, effective relief. Vicks Chloraseptic Spray quickly numbs the pain away. Got soreness from braces? Get Vicks Chloraseptic Spray. It numbs braces irritation on contact with a powerful anesthetic for fast, effective relief. Vicks Chloraseptic Spray quickly numbs the pain away.
It is still snowing in parts of the American Midwest. People there have to wonder when it's going to stop. At least 10 people have died, tens of thousands without power. The roads are treacherous at best. It's an early storm no one needed. The worst of it is in Cleveland. NBC's Jim Avila is there.
Cleveland's freak fall snowstorm is now in its fourth day. It's being measured in feet, not inches, up to 4 feet deep in East Cleveland.
It just keeps coming.
David Teitelbaum shoveled his driveway three times today, three times yesterday, and three times Sunday. He's one of 20,000 Cleveland area residents without electricity. His house is cold and dark, and there's no way to cook.
We go out and try to get something to eat, plow the driveway so we can go back in.
The wires that came down on Saturday night are in the same place they were 3 days ago, and the level of frustration here is as high as the snowbanks.
There. Howard Schumann has been living pioneer style since Saturday night. The fireplace provides the only heat and light. It's been 3 days of wearing jackets and gloves inside and bundling up in heavy comforters.
Well, this is about all you can do. You know, light your candles and sit by the fireplace like, it's kind of like Abe Lincoln.
Some progress is being made. These seniors were kept out of their homes because of the power problems. After three nights on cots at a Red Cross shelter,
The fire department brought them home this afternoon. Ada Glover's apartment was just as she left it early Sunday morning when it went dark and cold. Radios playing and all.
It's no place like home.
The heavy snows have surprised Cleveland. It's in the heart of the snow belt, where northwest winds blow Great Lakes moisture over land, creating lake effect snow. Cleveland is used to it, up to 100 inches a year.
I can't believe that it's snowing this hard, this early in the year.
And that indeed has been the surprise. Last year there were more than 100 inches, 200 inches of snow in some areas around Cleveland. And this year already, people are worried that this will be even a worse winter than last. Brian?
Jim, how much commerce is getting done? Behind you doesn't look like a lot of activity.
I tell you, downtown Cleveland looks pretty much like a ghost town most of the day. Some people did return to work today, the first real work day of the work week, but it's pretty desolate here.
NBC's Jim Avila, kind enough to stand out in it for a second straight night for us, and we appreciate it. A lot more to tell you about as the news continues tonight, news involving three big American companies. The tale of the Texaco tapes continues. This was showdown day in the executive suite there, with Reverend Jesse Jackson paying a visit. Is the oil company looking right at a boycott? A car rental company involved in a racial storm. What the people who try harder have to say about charges that they favor certain people. And why the music you buy at Walmart may be different than what you buy right across the street. When we continue.
It's called co-sourcing. What can it do for a business? It's how Saab is able to build a superior car in half the time, saving millions of krona. How Del Monte can predict the perfect point to pick their peaches. And why all 21 million of Taiwan's citizens are now covered by health insurance. It's a service from EDS. It's using information and technology to produce results.
Discover the feeling of Fixident Fresh for a strong, long hold. A secure, fresh approach to wearing dentures.
P, show some progress within 30 days in ending company discrimination or face economic reprisals.
If one makes the argument or raises the question, is affirmative action needed in America, you can spell the answer T-E-X-A-C-O.
But at a lunch meeting at Texaco headquarters, Jesse Jackson and other civil rights leaders turned up the pressure. If Texaco doesn't reach a settlement by Saturday in the discrimination lawsuit against the company, they'll call for customer boycotts and urge shareholders to sell their stock beginning this weekend.
We'll continue that kind of action until there's on the table a plan, goals, targets, and timetables for inclusion and the suit filed by the workers is settled.
We were served a good meal, but a firm agenda for fairness and equity was not on the menu.
Texaco's CEO called today's meeting a start, but said a boycott won't solve anything.
Boycotts are divisive. Boycotts, in my view, cause economic disruption. And I would certainly hope that we do not get to the stage where a boycott is seen as being a positive in a very difficult situation.
After inching through the courts for 2 years, the lawsuit filed by six black employees now has the potential to be much bigger, with pressure on Texaco to make it a class action settlement, applying to all the company's 1,400 black employees.
Lawyers for both sides continue talking, but Texaco says it's unlikely the discrimination lawsuit can be settled by this weekend. Pete Williams, NBC News, Washington. And now there are charges of racism against another corporate giant, Avis, the rent-a-car company that says it tries harder. A lawsuit charges some Avis employees were told to find reasons not to rent to African-American clients. NBC's Frederica Whitfield reports.
This time it's Avis Rent-A-Car under fire for alleged racist actions. In a class action lawsuit, 86 African Americans claim the rental car company has, quote, instituted policies and practices that treat African Americans less favorably. At the center of the lawsuit is Avis franchise owner John Dalton, headquartered here in North Carolina. He owns six Avis rental cars in two states. The plaintiffs accused Dalton of having his employees search for reasons to deny car rentals to African-American customers, quote, higher rates to blacks, and falsely telling African-Americans that no rental cars are available. Dalton and his attorney refused to return calls to NBC News. One plaintiff, Lurline Wilson, says she was hurt and insulted when she tried to rent a car from Avis for a 400-mile road trip 2 years ago.
and they told me that I was too old to drive that far.
She was 54 at the time with a valid driver's license.
I walked next door to National and I got a car.
Linda Pugh says she was told no vehicles were available when she arrived, even though she had reservations.
It was really a hurtful incident. It was humiliating. And to this very day, it has changed my personal relationship with some of my friends.
In addition to the plaintiff's stories, former Avis employees like Kenneth Ross Jessup said in a sworn statement that franchise owner Dalton told them to make it more difficult for black individuals because they were the highest risk rental traffic, especially if long trips were involved.
High mileage rentals to black folks automatically assumed that they were a drug dealer or you were not going to ever see the car again.
Late this afternoon, Avis corporate headquarters told NBC News, quote, Avis is extremely concerned about the reports we're getting. We want the truth to come out, and we're evaluating the courses of action that are open to Avis. The plaintiffs are seeking an undisclosed amount in damages, but most of all, they want the courts to order both Avis and its franchises to take steps towards ending any discriminatory practices. Frederica Whitfield, NBC News, Atlanta.
It is the second Army sex scandal in less than a week, this time at Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri, one of the nation's biggest basic training centers. The Army says three instructors, all officers, were charged with sexual misconduct with young women recruits. One pleaded guilty. The other two will be court-martialed, and officials say there will be more charges to come. The Army says the charges at Fort Leonard Wood are unrelated to the unfolding rape and sexual harassment scandal at the Aberdeen Proving Ground in Maryland. When the news continues tonight, why the CDs you buy at Walmart may actually sound different from those purchased from a music store. That and more after this.
It's a new day, and the world is changing. That's why the people of MSNBC Daytime are bringing it to you in a whole new way. More than just headlines, they keep you in touch with what matters to you on cable and on the internet. Personal, insightful, interactive. To spend your day with MSNBC and get closer to your world. MSNBC Daytime. It's time to get connected.
If you want more computer for your money, you gotta call us, the friendly folks at Gateway 2000.
Phone is back up. Pick up the phone and give us a call.
Call now. Call now. Call now.
I'm kinda nervous.
Call now.
Grab the phone. Give us a call. Pick up.
Dial, dial.
Dial.
Right now.
Gateway computers feature the Intel Pentium processor. So call 1-800-GATEWAY and ask for our free video. Call us today.
Every month, enter the world of fine interior design. Enter the fascinating world of Architectural Digest. View a pied-à-terre in Paris and an English designer's bright and airy London home. Call now and get 12 issues of Architectural Digest for only $29.95. You'll also receive absolutely free Celebrity Homes Revisited, a tour that includes the homes of Jeffrey Bean, Pavarotti, and Cher.
Call toll-free 800-952-2626. That's 800-952-2626.
The discount store chain Walmart has been accused of driving smaller mom-and-pop operations out of business when it swoops into town and offers lower prices on everything. Now, Walmart is under fire for what some say is music censorship, requiring record companies to conform to the chain's standards or risk banishment from store shelves. One artist who won't be found at Walmart's on the CD racks is Sheryl Crow because of something she says on her latest release. You'll have to find it in some other store.
That makes you happy.
Walmart's decision not to stock Sheryl Crow's latest CD was in response to a controversial lyric in one of her songs. It's about children killing children with guns. Guns, as she puts it, they bought at Walmart discount stores. The chain objected to the lyrics, characterizing them as unfair and offensive. But a front page story in today's New York Times revealed Walmart's music policy has a lot to say about a lot of artists. The chain refuses to stock any music with so-called explicit lyrics. Even those albums and CDs marked with industry labels warning parents of potentially objectionable material are banned. To comply with Walmart's policy and avoid taking a hit on profits, many record labels are altering music and CD cover art that the discount chain finds objectionable, even putting a bikini on a nude model. Walmart puts its own labels on the sanitized music. Beavis and Butthead are also banned at Walmart. The content of the discussion between the characters has been deemed too much. Today, the discount retailer issued its statement explaining their music standards practices. If a vendor wants to extend a product to Walmart or any other family-oriented store, they will need to deliver a product that retailers are comfortable offering to their customers. It is our right as a retailer to offer the type of products we want and we feel our customers want to buy.
They're trying to direct the life of the youths and even older people who like to listen to that music. They feel that what they think is right and nobody else's opinion counts.
Walmart doesn't care about music. It's a political thing for them. So the artist is going to have to be affected by that.
Walmart is not alone in placing standards on entertainment products. Video giant Blockbuster and discount retail store Kmart sell edited versions of some movies. Now the question, should Walmart and other retailers restrict products sold in their stores? Our next two guests have very different answers to that question. Tom Tompkins is the arts editor for the San Francisco Bay Guardian. He joins us from our NBC affiliate Cron in San Francisco. Bob Peters is president of Morality and Media. He joins us tonight from 30 Rock New York Studios. Thank you both gentlemen for coming in. Tom, let's begin with you. What do you make of Walmart's CD policy?
Well, I think that it's wrong, and I also think that it's futile. There's a fairly long history of trying to censor pop music, which means both scapegoating pop music for social problems, and it's never worked, and it's never been right.
But hey, how is it futile if you walk out of Walmart, maybe unknowingly, but you've purchased a CD that's been cleaned up, and so nothing objectionable comes out of your stereo at home? Then that means the policy worked, correct?
Well, perhaps in Walmart it works, but I would say that essentially when there's music out there, kids find a way of getting a hold of that music, and for good reason. I also think that as any parent could tell you, if you tell a kid, don't listen to this, this is not for you, this is bad, kids will go out of their way to try to find it.
Bob Peters, that's a pretty traditional argument, telling kids don't go near the cookie jar because there's cookies in there and they're going to make a beeline for it.
Well, I don't see it. Walmart is trying to dictate what's going to be sold in the American marketplace. I see it as an act of corporate responsibility on the part of Walmart to have some standards in terms of the content of the entertainment they offer to their customers. I say with somewhat of a smile, it's clear, I think, to most Americans that much of the mainstream entertainment media abandoned standards of decency and morality quite some time ago. And personally, I think it's a grand thing that at least one major American corporation, Walmart, is willing to say, we have some standards. We're not trying to force you as an artist what to produce. But if you want to sell it in our store, you're going to have to meet our standards. If you don't want to sell it in our store, if you want to have the four-letter words and the nudity and the Satanism or whatever the standards are, then you sell it someplace else. And I think that's very much Walmart's right under the First Amendment. It has nothing to do with government censorship, and it's not a First Amendment issue in terms of a prohibition.
Tom Tompkins, I'm imagining this doesn't thrill a lot of artists.
I don't think anybody who really thinks seriously about any social issues would be thrilled by something like this. I mean, I think that what one needs to size up is there are people who think that lack of exposure to ideas solves social problems, and there's others, as I do, who feel that much exposure to social to ideas is exactly the solution to social problems, because people can understand things and be free to make their own choices on them from a position of knowledge and not from a position of ignorance.
Well, I for one don't really see it primarily as a matter of ideas. To my knowledge, Walmart and Blockbuster aren't censoring videos based on whether they agree or disagree with a political or social viewpoint. They are saying that there are limits in terms of sexually explicit nudity and gross obscenity that we're going to sell in our stores. And I tell you, there is no thought that can't be communicated without four-letter words, and no political, social, moral, religious viewpoint that can't be communicated without pornography. So ideas, I don't see it. Trashy talk, and pornographic lewd behavior or exhibitions. That's what we're talking about with Walmart's policy and also with Blockbuster's policy. And if you like a lot of skin, if you like a lot of vulgarity and drug promotion, you're not going to like Walmart's policy. But in my opinion, that's too bad.
Tom, aside from the fact that Walmart has kind of made a choice for all the consumers that enter its store preemptively, that you can only buy certain kinds of things, do you think this is further selective? Are they targeting certain kinds of artists or music?
Well, I think in general, at least in recent years, if we're talking about censoring music, we're talking about censoring hip-hop. And personally, I feel that censoring hip-hop music goes hand in hand with a country that really wishes the problems of inner cities and African American youth in particular would just disappear, which quite obviously is not going to happen. I also think that it's really dangerous for us to sit here and say, well, of course, what Walmart is doing is just these certain kinds of CDs or videos that are not being allowed to be sold there. I think 40 years ago, out in the Bay Area, there was a landmark case when Allen Ginsberg's poem "Howl" was attacked legally on the grounds that it was obscene.
That has to be the last word. I'm sorry, we are running out of time in this segment. Tom Topkins, Bob Peters, I thank you both for taking part, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Trusting the wrong diarrhea medicine can put you in a very uncomfortable position. But you can count on Imodium AD to stop diarrhea, often in one dose. You could end up taking dose after dose after dose of the pink stuff to stop diarrhea as effectively as Imodium AD. Don't take chances with diarrhea.
You shouldn't take an
Imodium
AD.
Take Imodium AD.
Sorry.
One dose relief you can count on.
Went to the mall. I like to write stories. They're important because if everybody wrote, everybody would have a bigger imagination.
I could design a rocket ship. I could take paper airplanes and on the inside tape them together.
My pictures are very important to my dad because when I tell him that I love him with a picture, he can keep it forever.
International Paper. We answer to the world.
Next on The Site. Getting mail to loved ones in the military used to take weeks. Now it takes seconds. Technology that's making the world smaller. Next on MSNBC.
Do you know you might be spending double what you need to for your life insurance? Have a pencil ready. In a moment, I'll give you a toll-free number you can call to find out. American Republic Insurance Company has a breakthrough buying system for purchasing low-cost, high-quality term life insurance. By using an 800 number, you now buy direct from the company. These are policies that can also save you hundreds of dollars a year. Want proof? $30 a month, just a dollar a day, buys $369,000 of coverage for a man age 35. Also, for a dollar a day, a woman age 35 can buy $430,000 of coverage. And these rates are guaranteed level for 10 years. Get your free no-obligation custom quote and full information. Call the company direct at 1-800-952-2626. American Republic. The direct-to-you way to buy the most term life insurance at a truly low cost. Stop overspending. Call this toll-free number today. 1-800-952-2626.
Late today, the Justice Department rejected a request to appoint an independent counsel to investigate those contributions to the Clinton re-election campaign. Arizona Republican Senator John McCain had made the request, citing news reports that the Democrats got potentially illegal foreign contributions. In rejecting McCain's request, Justice said the senator had failed to provide specific evidence of any kind of a federal crime. This was the day that was supposed to be the "Why Can't We All Get Along" meeting at the White House between the president and the leaders of the new 105th Congress. Before the meeting, President Clinton told reporters at an Oval Office unrelated signing ceremony he'd be willing to accept a balanced budget amendment if it were flexible enough to cope with a recession. Later, the Republicans came out of the meeting saying it was a positive, constructive session, but they always say that. There was at least one note of acrimony. Senate Majority Leader Trent Lott said he'll leave it to the president to come up with ways to reform Medicare. They did ban cameras in the Oval Office before they got underway. Also tonight, White House officials tell NBC News President Clinton may not name a new Secretary of State this week, as he had hoped because the deal is not yet done. We're told retired General Colin Powell's name does not appear on the short list for Secretary of State or Defense. Meantime, late today, Transportation Secretary Federico Pena made it official. He will be resigning from the Clinton cabinet. Utah Congresswoman Enid Green, formerly Enid Waldholtz, was among the Republican freshmen who came in with a bang after the 94 election. This year, she is packing her bags and leaving Washington. Green was regarded as a shrewd politician, yet she had no idea her husband and campaign treasurer, Joel Waldholtz, was allegedly running a massive fraud. Tonight on NBC Nightly News, Tom Brokaw profiled and sat down to talk with Enid Green.
Freshman Congresswoman Enid Green's life sounds like a soap opera.
On the election?
She came to Washington from Utah in 1994, and from the start, Republicans saw her as a rising star, one who would help deliver House Speaker Newt Gingrich's contract with America. She was hyped as a symbol of the future as she walked the halls of Congress while pregnant with her first child. But just 2 months after she gave birth, Green's husband, Joe Waldholtz, who was her campaign treasurer, vanished. Green learned that her husband was a con man for 5 years, spinning elaborate lies to her and everyone else. In fact, she now knows his family was not wealthy. He had grossly misspent her campaign money. Green was then tied to an illegal campaign funding scheme where she says Joe cheated her own father out of $2 million. Her husband was found to be the mastermind of the fraud. He was sentenced to 37 months in prison for writing $3 million in phony checks and deceiving tax officials. Then, early this month, the Justice Department cleared Enid Green of all criminal charges. Now, her husband claims he is addicted to heroin.
No.
The saga has left Green broke and moving out of Congress, moving on with her life, but often looking back.
What attracted you to him in the first place?
He was intelligent. He was funny. And he helped me believe more in myself.
Had a man ever paid as much attention to you before?
No.
Was that part of it as well?
Of course it was. I had always been very successful in my professional life, but I had never been very good at my personal life. And here came someone who not only made me feel wonderful, I believed that he believed that I was wonderful. I thought I had finally found what I had basically given up on ever finding.
But was that part of the con?
Of course it was. I know that now.
But the warning bells at some point to corporate lawyer, Enid Green, had at some point to accumulate.
I was with him when he would use his American Express card. The clerk would try to put it through, it would flash up and say it's been refused, and Joe would get on the phone and explain to them how there had been fraud on his card, and the clerk would routinely okay the transaction. I knew that there were a series of problems, but I knew the Joe explanation. I realize how ridiculous it seems in hindsight.
Why didn't you resign when it was all revealed?
I did not resign because I'm not guilty of trying to break the election laws.
Wouldn't it have been a marvelous signal to the country for you to have said, I'm here under fraudulent circumstances?
If I had any knowledge of this, then I not only should have resigned, but I should have been indicted and tried and gone to prison. But I didn't.
You have a daughter by Joe. He's the father. Do you want him to ever see his daughter again?
I want whatever is best for my daughter.
His daughter as well.
There's more to being a father than genetics. And he has not been a father to Elizabeth thus far in her life.
Could you ever trust your emotions to another man?
I would like to think I could. For someone who deserved it. I don't know.
Enid Green is returning to Salt Lake City and her family, and she's not ruled out a return to elective office someday. We want to correct something that was said on this broadcast last night that was wrong, but not entirely our fault. The Associated Press had reported that Republican Congressman Chris Shays of Connecticut had urged Speaker Gingrich to step aside until an ethics investigation is complete. Today, AP ran on the wire a correction, saying that what Shays said was he wouldn't vote for Gingrich as Speaker if the ethics report wasn't out by the time the House is to vote. We all stand corrected. When we come back, a look at what's in the morning papers.
I keep reading about this one mutual fund, so I ask them about it. OR Blah Blah Fund is just as good, but I don't see their Blah Blah Fund on this list. Now what?
At Schwab, we don't push funds. We show you performance in our mutual fund select list. Call 1-800-790-7715 and get your copy free.
So it's Monday morning, and I decide to move money from one fund to another. I gotta call up one fund, wait for a check, mail the check, wait for it to clear. Now it's next Monday.
With Mutual Fund OneSource, choose from hundreds of no-load funds and get one statement. Which to choose? Call Schwab for our select list free.
They recommend this, then that. Then they recommend I sell the first thing they recommended.
This was supposed to be easy.
Now what do I do?
Then I get my statement. Ouch.
Get someone on your side. Get the investment firm where no one is on commission. Call 1-800-790-7715 and get our mutual fund select list absolutely free.
Take strokes off your game, guaranteed.
Jack Nicklaus's personal technique that helps straighten slices.
Take strokes off your game, guaranteed.
Dave Peltz's revolutionary technique that has even the pros putting more accurately.
Take strokes off your game, guaranteed.
Get out of sand without sweat. Greg Norman's Earth Mover secret shows you how. Guaranteed. Now take two, three, four, even more strokes off your game with the secrets you'll get in your free issue of Golf Magazine.
Take strokes off your game. Guaranteed.
Master teacher Jim McClain's simple secret to longer, straighter tee shots every time. Call now to get your free issue of Golf Magazine, plus receive your free Golf Magazine umbrella. Shoot lower, play better, or you don't pay. That's the Golf Magazine guarantee. Call now for your free no-obligation issue of Golf Magazine. If you decide to subscribe, get 11 more issues, 12 in all, for just $16.97. Plus this Golf Magazine umbrella free with your paid subscription. Call now.
From Los Angeles, Chicago, New York, and Washington, we have a look at some of the front pages tomorrow morning, beginning with the Los Angeles Times. After Colonel Bernadine wrote the high court talking about assisted suicide, now the Clinton administration is on the record rejecting that idea that terminally ill people should get help ending their lives. Their theory is there would be no stopping point should the law allow assisted suicide, and it could easily be abused. Chicago Trib, front page above the fold. Ousted Pakistani Prime Minister moves out and speaks out. Benazir Bhutto had to move out of her official residence and into a private home. New York Times, front page below the fold. Second day of Bosnia fighting is worse since 95 pact. That pact is the Dayton Accords. This is a story worth watching. Firefight broke out there yesterday, their time, between Muslims trying to return to their former homes and Serbs who were trying to keep them out. And Washington Post, don't cry for me, Argentina, out of the fire, into the frying pan. For the burned out, cooking is a hot career. With layoffs rampant in other industries, especially Sunbeam, chefs like Spago's Wolfgang Puck are landing superstar status. Enrollment at culinary schools has more than doubled in the past 5 years. Finally tonight, the steady parade of Kennedy memorabilia for sale to the highest bidder is not yet over. There was one more thing on the auction block tonight. The stock ticker from the day President John F. Kennedy was assassinated. It's a roll of paper, just as it appears there. It was sold at Sotheby's in New York for $8,625. The tape is 15 sheets long with a minute-by-minute reporting of the day's financial dealings that day. But the Dow numbers were interrupted by the Associated Press report. It read, President Kennedy was shot today just as his motorcade left downtown Dallas. There is the point at which it was interrupted during the stock report. And that is the news for this Tuesday night. I'm Brian Williams. We ask that you stay tuned for the site immediately following this broadcast. Don't forget, I'm us in the morning. We hope to see you right back here tomorrow night for all of us here. Good night.